Search engine optimization, or SEO, is a massive industry, and it's seeing a lot of AI being applied because there's a lot of repeatable tasks, a lot of human bias, and a lot of research that needs to be done. These are the kinds of repeatable tasks that the AI of today is particularly good at. Hey, I'm Max, the original Flowgrammer, and this is the Studio Update, the show where I tell the stories of Flowgrammers from across NNN's global community. For most SEO consultants, a client engagement starts with an SEO audit. There's various technical checks that need to be done on every single page of the client's site. Then there's numerous layers of research that they have to do as well. Marketplace analyses, competitor analyses, content themes. And then from there, they have to synthesize all that research and turn it into recommendations for messaging on the website, keywords for search, landing pages and blog pages to attract all the inbound interest, all the things that people are actively searching for today so that their page ranks for those search terms. Historically, that is a mountain of work for an SEO consultant. I met with Sharique, who's been in the SEO game for over 6 years, and he showed me an AI use case that automates the majority of this process while keeping him in control so he can leverage his years of experience while doing it all faster. To put it in context, when he's working manually in his prime on a best month, he can maintain 15 clients at a time. With the solution I'm about to show you, he now has over 50 clients at a time, and he's confident he can push that number. He uses NNN to power the back end of his solution, and then Airtable for his front end. Now, I think the really pro thing that he did that makes his solution effective is, as a domain expert, he modeled. Shit. I almost slipped down steps, guys. All right. Sorry, Luis, not worth it. The neat thing is that each step of his process is modeled on the human process. Given he's an SEO consultant, he's an expert at that process. I think that's the first key to success. And then the second one is that each step runs and then adds that to a view in Airtable with a human, the SEO consultant, can check that, easily tweak it, and then running the next step. So far, anyone that knows anything about AI says shit inputs, shit outputs. So logically, good inputs, good outputs. And if you have a multi-step process where you need inputs at each step, adding human in the loop at each step, especially where there's a domain expert at the wheels, leads to good results, as you'll see in this interview. I think it's also a great example of chat is not the only interface for AI, and very often it's not the best interface. I definitely think that's a trend we'll see in 2025 and beyond. And without further ado, let's check out Sharique's use case. Hey, Sharique, would you mind introducing yourself?
As I'm Sharique, I have been running SEO agency for quite a while. And right now I'm more of focused towards building some AI agents specifically for SEO space.
How long have you been in the SEO space?
I have been into this SEO space for a long time, somewhere around like 5 to 7 years. And in that entire process, I have been running this entire SEO campaigns for the biggest of the biggest brands out there.
And I'm guessing there's a lot of AI kind of working its way into SEO work, I would imagine.
Yeah, 100%. There's a lot of things which is actually going on right now in this AI and SEO space. This AI space, it's going wild out there. It's pretty insane. The other day you wake up and it's like whole different shenanigans which goes out there.
Yeah, I think shenanigans is the perfect way to put it. So I think it's a perfect segue, Sharique. Would you mind letting me know what your use case is and what kind of motivated you to automate it?
I was been into this SEO space for quite a while, been running this SEO campaigns. For me, the biggest bottleneck in that entire process was putting together a better research strategy and a tech audit part, which usually take me a lot of time. Even though I was in my prime, it was very difficult for me to manage most of my clients, and it was very difficult for me to scale. Then I actually took a step back and understood that how would I automate that entire process? Now, since we have done that, I can easily manage 50 clients at once without compromising all the quality. And we are seeing some insane results with most of our clients.
You do these reports for these clients as part of SEO work. How many were you doing before in prime at your maximum without AI?
Oh man, it was 10 to 15 clients.
Is that a maximum? So that was maximum 15 clients that you could support?
Yeah, absolutely. That was the max I could ever go.
And that's doing it manually. And so now you basically, with AI, automated a lot of this report stuff. And you're saying you can now do like 50 clients at a time?
Right now, there's no number to it. I'm pretty sure I can go beyond that as well.
Billables, billables, billables. I love it, Sharique. All right. Show me the money. Could you share your screen and show me your workflow?
I would love to do that for you. So what we do here is we first go ahead and click in your project name, specify your URL, specify your location code. Are you helping the system understand what is the exact region you want to target, the regionalization?
Sorry, Sharique, for us who aren't SEO experts,
Is a location code, does like every country have a location in SEO as a location code?
No. So you can see all of the different locations have different location codes.
Got you. Okay. So this focuses like the research and everything the AI is going to do for that specific region.
Yeah, exactly. Just like the location sheet I've shared you, we also have what is the language you want to go and target on. You have that flexibility to go ahead and run an SEO campaign as a polylingual way. You come here in the action part. The first step is you go ahead and click on audit tech issues. The moment you hit this button, another workflow kicks in, which does a URL level inspection of your website. You see here, at this URL level inspection tries to identify all of the different problems which is there on your website. And these problems are being segmented on the basis of on-page report, be it meta title, their length, meta description, H1 tags, and image alt tags, technical issues like 3xx issues, 4xx issues, and everything. I'm not going to bore you with all of the different technical jargons out here.
It sounds like I've seen SaaS apps that sell just this. Is that right? This is like a whole industry in and of itself of just doing this, these technical audits.
You're absolutely right. We are combining Screaming Frog and Ahrefs audit at one place. You don't have to like juggle between the tools back and forth in order to get your audit report. Then moreover, it helps you identify the page speed, few of the recommendations. Then you move on to the next part, identifying your target audience and really digging deep onto them. Now, coming back to the action tab, the moment you hit generate project details, another AI agent kicks in order to identify who exactly is your target audience, what is your offer, and moreover, what is the content pillars that needs to be written in order to identify the target audience. And moreover, once that is done, tries to understand how are you different than most of your competitors. Think of it like an USP of sort. To the next action step, which is the keyword research. You hit keyword research tab. Now, once you do that, another AI agents start to do a keyword research for you. This keyword research has been broken down into multiple steps. First part is the parent topic. Now, the moment you hit that button out there, the keyword research part, the AI agent goes ahead and tries to understand what are the different parent topics, ideally what you can write in order to attract that set of target audience, which identified in the very first step.
Where are these parent topics coming from? Is it coming from a previous step, or is this sort of research that it's doing in the end-to-end workflow?
It's more of the research phase, which's actually happening on the end-to-end. And from there, the entire data has been contextualized and been put into the A table part. And once we have identified what are the parent topics, what are the secondary keywords, the competition level, the search volume, then we try to do something called as segregation of the context. What do I mean by that? The moment you hit generate topic, this is where the actual magic starts to happen. This system goes ahead and tries to segment that topic into multiple silos. You see, SEO application for finance and specific sectors was one of the key topics which we identified in the previous stage. The system suggests this very respective parent topic have 30 silos into it, and that each silos should have their child topics into it. And these silo topics are then segmented in a way that you kind of have an understanding of what are the relevant permutations and combinations that needs to be written in order to have a topical authority in the niche. And once you identify that, okay, this is the silo topic I want to go ahead and get started to create an authority on, the next part, which is the content creation part. The child topic is creating the financial content. What are the semantically related keywords? It actually went ahead and understood what are the secondary keywords for the fact. Once that is done and you have identified that, okay, this is the content I want to go ahead and create a web page on, you click on generate blog. Now, the moment you go ahead and click on generate blog, a research agent has been kicked in order to formulate a unique ranking hypothesis, which then will be used by the content writer agent. This is the main topic, and these are the semantically related keywords. If the keywords are not actually correct, it will go ahead and remove the keywords from the secondary keywords, and it will go ahead and add suggested keywords. It checks the coherence, whether you have a very specific content, you have a very specific content with a tight cluster. Once we are done with that, the first process of checking the coherence between the primary keywords and the secondary keywords, it dig deeps onto what are the SERPs saying for it. What are the top competitor links out there on the very respective SERPs? And once the top identification of competitors has been done, it moves on to the search intent analysis. The search intent for secondary keyword varies. So it dig deeps onto what are the sub intents and the sub intents inside the main keyword, which would definitely be missed by most of the SEO experts out there. Then once that process is done, it tries to identify what are the key subtopics that has been discussed in the top ranking articles on the SERPs. And once that is done, it deeps onto understanding what is that most of the competitors are talking on the SERPs and what are the things what most of them have missed on the very respective keyword and yada, yada, yada. And then this tool, this research agent, has also access to Perplexity and all the other AI tools. Whenever it needs to do a more in-depth research, it can call those tools by itself and do a research for a better insight for the content.
This research, this is a step that a human would do when they're doing this report. Is that right?
100%. Before, this exact process of the search brief was something which used to take me a lot of time, and I bet most of the SEOs out there struggles in order to go ahead and do this very detailed research.
This is a raw input, that research document. Is that better than a junior would do?
Of course, yes, man. There's a lot more better than mid-level to advanced level SEO expertise out there. And then once we are done with that, it highlights what are the outline suggestions and everything, how the content should be actually structured. Once this process is done, it deeps onto finding the unique ranking hypothesis. And once this entire information has been collected, then passes down this entire research brief to the content writing agent. This content writing agent has been fine-tuned on your choice of words, your branding style.
I love how this is built in Airtable. And thank you so much for not making a chat AI agent. This is not a chat use case. My first thought was like, why doesn't he have this just automatically every step run? And I think the answer is going to be because the way you have it in Airtable, there's this beautiful, like perfect human in the loop. You as the expert, look at this, you change a word here, you remove that citation, you tweak something, and then you go to the next step. So each step, you're getting a human audit, a human opportunity to say, hey, wait, no, this one's more important. Tweak this a little bit, a couple percent of that human context. I'm guessing the results are way better, right?
Yeah, amazingly better. We have been doing this for way number of clients of ours, and the results are like pretty insane. The articles are like quickly ranked, and these guys are pulling some insane torrential downpour of traffic towards their website.
That's so cool to hear.
Once the entire content is being produced, it generates the meta title, meta description, the slug, and also generates an image prompt. And the moment you hit this button, generate image, it will go ahead and generate a featured image, which is again fine-tuned on your choice, on your branding guidelines, and then directly push on your website.
Wow. That's super powerful. This is end to end. I'm so curious. What happens under the hood?
I can walk you through the process. This is how exactly the system looks like. It's like the behemoth of the automation.
Look at that flow, gang.
So actually, the backend is set up from here on the Airtable automations. You can see they're pinging all of the webhook requests and everything.
You're using Airtable's basically triggering and to a generic webhook into NAN. And then you got that switch node that's like routing to all the different cases that it could be, right?
Yeah, exactly. Now, I would love to walk you through the research team and the content writer agent. The moment you hit that button, it gets a record, the Airtable gets a record and passes down to the research team. And this research team has access to multiple tools and an LLM model like Scrape Site Tool, the SERP Scraper and Perplexity. If I open up this for you real quick, this is a research agent, and this research agent can go ahead and call the tools multiple times wherever it needs to in order to do the in-depth level of research. This is attached to Gemini chat model because we have experimented with OpenAI as in other models as well. But we have seen that Google Gemini chat model is something which is very good at calling tools. Now, once the entire research has been completed, it updates a record into Airtable and then passes that research brief to the writer agent. Now, this writer agent has access to, again, Perplexity tool as well. Let's just say that there is some specific type of research that needs to be done before the writing process. This writer agent also kind of like pulls the data, pulls the research if that's something the writer agent wants to highlight further. And then once this entire process is completed, it extracts that information and then updates the record for it.
Sharique, would you mind if we take a quick peek at the system prompt for the writer agent?
This is exactly how the writer agent has been positioned.
We got an example, some multi-shot prompting in there. Okay, got you.
Yeah, the sources and everything, the topic, the parent topic, the semantically related keywords. We are pulling all of the different dynamic fields out there from here. So it has the context on what exactly the content needs to be written or be, or what is the entire research that has been passed through in reference to the keyword.
Then you're basically piping in the stuff from the last Airtable step then into that prompt. So it combines with the static. Makes a lot of sense.
This is a very basic system what we have built for most of the B2B and the service-based businesses. But you know what, actually, at a strategy level, SEO changes. What do I mean by that? When you are doing an SEO for e-commerce or for SaaS or for an enterprise or for local business, the entire strategy changes. So this is just the starting layer we are kind of like scratching right now. We are, like I said, we are seeing some insane seen results out of it.
I think for a lot of people watching, they'll be like, wow, I didn't realize you could do that with end-to-end and with automation and AI. But I totally agree. And I think it's a great reason why some of the stuff you're doing here, probably some off-the-shelf tools can do parts of it. But now that you took the time to build out a custom system, obviously there's a little bit more overhead perhaps, but you can make it perfect for e-com. You can make it perfect for medtech. You can make it perfect for that hot new industry that comes out a year from now that we don't know about. Or you could white label this. Maybe there's some big SEO agency that wants to license it, has to run on their own servers. I'm sure for the right price, you could do that as well.
100%, Mac. There's one thing. There's no limitation on what we can actually do over the top of the system. If you want to have a very detailed report, which you want to send it over to your client, definitely you can do that too. There's one more thing I would like to highlight here. Most of the people out there, they see automation as the big thing. But I believe automation is as good as your own internal processes. If you have a very strong foundation of what is exactly you want to automate, you can't automate and get results what you desire. It's a classic example of garbage in and garbage out.
Absolutely. And I think garbage in, garbage out was one of the things when I was looking at what you were doing. Some people, like when ChatGPT first came out, people tried to write an SEO report. Obviously, it was garbage. No context. And I think what you showed today is a great example of add context, then add context, then add context, then add context, then do. And how you modeled it. And I think this is the biggest advice I can give folks is like structure it into discrete steps. Like you had a researcher and then a writer. I'm guessing that was inspired by the fact that's like the humans that do it in the process already. Even if it's the same person, it's the hat you put on. It's like, all right, I got my research hat on now. My advice to folks is study the human process, know it. If you're not the one doing it, you got to go sit with the person, study it. It helps if you're the person, and model your AI agents and model your AI steps as those people. Like it's literally a team of agents getting the work done.
That's absolutely correct. Yeah, that's exactly what I've been seeing. And there's one more thing I would like to highlight is most of the people out there, they try to complicate the process. They try to have a multi-set layer of agent and try to have like a 50 or 60 different agents, which is kind of like doing a simple thing. But that's not how you should optimize the system. They say that the biggest complexity is in simplicity.
And I think you did a great level there. And I know we only saw part of the workflow because again, like I don't know if we can do a 5-hour video and all the details. You broke it down into two steps. And I think that's a perfect decision. Right? Because you have research and then synthesize it. And I think the nice pro tip, gang, is when you break down your steps like that as well, you happen to use Gemini for both, but there could be scenarios where one model is better at that task. So maybe Gemini is amazing at tool calling, but maybe if it's really important, maybe Anthropic will come in for writing content sometimes or whatever, right? These models are going to evolve. You can swap them out. Now, Sharique, since you're bullish on Google Gemini, which model specifically did you use for this use case? And which recommendations do you have for folks in the Gemini family?
It's more of towards the 1206 model with a million context. I'm not just bullish on Google Gemini. I'm more keen towards what is the exact specific use case we're trying to get at. Let's just say that we want to generate content in a European language. What I've seen is Mistral is very good on crafting those European contextual terms, all right? And wherein Gemini is very good at calling the tools and doing the research part. And then we use Mistral in order to go ahead and generate the entire content in the like French or in German.
Got you. So right tool for the job, basically, just like in any kind of engineering. So Sharique, thank you so much for your time.
Pleasure's all mine.
If folks like what they see, where could they follow along for the journey?
I'm going ahead and posting a lot of content on LinkedIn. You folks can go and see out there. You can reach out to my email, which is sharique@cashcowlabs.io. And we can take things forward from there.
Beautiful. Well, Sharique, thanks again for your time. Appreciate it. Have a beautiful rest of your week, mate.
Yeah, all right, man. Thanks for having me again.
How big was that workflow, right? I think it's very funny in the end-to-end community, you sometimes say users saying, oh, I have a problem with my big workflow and it's 10 nodes. And as an Australian, I always think that's not a workflow. This is a workflow. So if you like what you saw, drop a comment and mash that like button. It really helps make sure I keep my job. And Americans will know what I mean when I say this, but I went to UMich, so I definitely got them student loans to be paying off on a euro salary. On that note, I'm in a beautiful location in Berlin. If you find yourself in Humboldthain Park in the summer, check the flat term. There might be a sneaky little rave happening there if you're lucky. But since I was filming up here, I'm technically on the clock, Luis. Don't forget it, brother. And I almost slipped and fell like 4 times. Look at all that ice. I'll be checking the workers' comp rules when I get home, Luis, or other ChatGPT will. On that note, I'm Max. This is The Studio. You're awesome and happy flotgramming.